Assalamu alaikum to our MTA viewers and welcome to another edition of Spectrum. In today's program, we are going to be looking at the launch of a very, very important report called Rabwah, A Place for Martyrs. This is a report that has been launched by Lord Eric Avery, the Vice Chair of the Parliamentary Human Rights Group. It captures the plight and persecution of Ahmadis in Pakistan. The Parliamentary Human Rights Group set up a mission towards the end of 2006 to go to Pakistan to look at the plight and persecution of Ahmadis. In particular, they wanted to focus on the question whether Rabwah was a safe place for Ahmadis. Many Ahmadis following persecution have fled to the West and UK, and occasionally the authorities say to those who are claiming asylum that perhaps that's where they should have gone, Rabwah, because there are a lot of Ahmadis and they should be safe there. And the report looks at this and addresses the issues. The mission comprised of a number of important people involved in human rights, and later on we will be interviewing some of these people. Ahmadis will know the problems faced by their fellow brothers and sisters following the declaration in 1974 as non-Muslims, and in particular the ordinances introduced by General Ziaul-Haq. Later on we will be asking Lord Avery of what more can be done to raise the awareness of the persecution faced by Ahmadis, and we will also be talking to Amir Saab. Spectrum will start off the program by interviewing Rafiq Hayat Saab, the Amir of UK, and asking him to explain the background to this very, very important report in the mission that was sent to Pakistan.
You see, what happened approximately 2 or 3 years ago, the courts in the United Kingdom started refusing some of our asylum applications on the basis that the applicants could go on internal flight into Rabwah if they had problems within the country. And they said that Rabwah was a safe city and therefore they could take refuge there instead of coming to the UK and seeking asylum here. It's taken 18 months for this report to be finalized and published, and it took them firstly a long time to put together a brief as to what they want to research before they went there. And they met a lot of people in Pakistan, people from different, from within our Jamaat. They also met a lot of people from the human rights groups there. They met people from Patnanduwat. They went and met some of the people from the government side as well, although officially the government did not want to have representation. The situation is deteriorating all the time. As you know that in Rabwah, we at one stage had all of the people in Rabwah, an FIR was issued against them. We recently had our presses seized and closed down. So the situation unfortunately hasn't improved at all. But although you continue to hear that the government has good intentions, but unfortunately it doesn't manifest itself on the ground level with all the good intentions that they may have.
On my right, I have Tom Salen, a barrister who is a member of the Immigration Law Practitioners Association, the Bar Human Rights Committee, and finally, in introducing Jonathan, may I pay a special word of thanks to him for the marvellous job he's done on editing.
Thank you, Eric. I suppose really the best thing that I could do is offer a perspective on the kind of focus of the report and what it is that we were trying to achieve. As has been mentioned, our exclusive focus, our exclusive interest was in the issue of internal flight alternatives, as it's termed in the UK courts, which is the concept that rather than gain asylum in the UK, those who do or potentially suffer persecution in their country of origin have an alternative safe haven, if you will, within their own state that they can safely return to. And this idea has been floated on a number of occasions in relation to money cases and the town of Rabwah. However, once we arrived in Pakistan and started our investigations, it quickly became apparent that it would be impossible to understand the situation in Rabwah itself without a much greater understanding of the broader social and political context within which religious minorities generally and Malays in particular live in within Pakistan. So whilst the main role of this report is to inform on issues directly relating to internal fight, there is some background material as well.
That's what you're asking.
I think Robin said it all, didn't we?
Sorry, Don.
I think, as you can see, this is a factual report of what both the Ahmadis and others say about that life. And it's a comprehensive picture, I think you'll agree. These are the circumstances which the immigration judges and the practitioners will need to take into consideration. And they come from such an authoritative source in the three practitioners that we commissioned to conduct this survey, that I think there will be of an immense influence. I certainly hope so, and that is the purpose of the report.
If I could ask, the change society takes decades and generations, but those in power and those in leadership have a duty to legislate and to show leadership, and I just find it extremely worrying, that comment, to be honest, because part of the question is what do we in the UK and the Western world and the rest of the world do about this situation, and part of it has to be to influence the leaders in Pakistan to change. If we're waiting to change Pakistani society, that could take ages.
Was your investigation being conducted in a very sort of discreet manner? Because now in Pakistan there are so many private local channels, TV channels, and they're always looking for information. They have a lot of panel discussions and stuff, some of which for Pakistan has been quite interesting and eye-opening. And I really do think if there's a way to work with certain maybe newspapers over there or the media and just sort of get the message out in a certain way.
We were given the visa, granted the visa, on the condition that we will not publicize too much the investigation or the mission.
It wouldn't have been appropriate for us to do so either. I mean, we have a very clear mandate in terms of what it was we were trying to achieve. We had a research mandate in terms of gathering evidence.
So your conclusion is missing. Why could you not say, for example, if in your view that Rabwah is a safe haven, turning flight or what have you?
Had this report been of a different nature and had the investigation been of a different nature, then we would have been able to do that.
Since has justified any kind of discrimination like the CBS idea. We all have our beliefs and our traditions, and they differ, and they sometimes differ in important ways. People feel strongly about it. But I think the more you see the differences in people, the more you see the similarities. I look forward to the day when I say to my local mosque, tell me about the range of Muslims that we have in the world, that we have in this country. They'll describe the same that I will describe the different denominations of the Christian religion. And people again may at one stage have felt very active about this. Now they can treat it in more of a scholarly way, treat the local state the way they treat their own.
Because the one dangerous place in the world is to stand between a member of parliament and a photograph.
But also to consider these important issues of how the evidence is going to be seen by the immigration judges, what the content of the report should be, as Jonathan explained originally, in order to have the maximum impact. And not only did we have asked the three practitioners who went to Rabwah, looking at this, but we also had another very distinguished barrister who was advising us that this report fulfills the functions that the Parliamentary Human Rights Group had intended. That is to say, that it will be a piece of evidence which is seen by the court as objective and which will therefore be far more influential.
I think this will help a lot of Ahmadis who are in a lot of trouble in this country. And I think this report will... I know the pain, having left a country where they've been persecuted and coming here, and then having to go through the pain, being told that, no, you know, you can go back there because there's a safe haven there for you, is a nightmare that I see them every day they come to my office. Mm. And they're in absolute agony and tears. And I think, hopefully, this will assist their cases in this country. Of course, the issue of internal flight is very much linked to the persecution itself. You can't separate the two issues. And hopefully, from this report, you know, we can build on it now and try and see if we can bring about change. I do think there are a lot of good people in Pakistan who would like to see change in Pakistan. I continue to see reports in the media where some of the senior politicians also would like to see change. Eric, I know you for a long time, you've been trying to assist us in this matter. So God bless you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I was contacted back in December 2005 when the Parliamentary Human Rights Group first conceived the idea of travelling to Pakistan to investigate the reality of what's known as an internal flight alternative for Ahmadis who come to the UK claiming asylum on the basis of persecution within Pakistan. And an issue that frequently comes up in those cases is the suggestion that Ahmadis could actually travel to Rabwah and effectively gain a safe haven within their country of origin and so fail in their asylum claim in the UK. This had been brought to the attention of the Parliamentary Human Rights Group on a number of occasions, and they felt that it was an issue that lacked sufficient evidence and that they would like to address that particular absence of evidence by putting together a team of people to go and investigate that issue in particular. So the role and purpose of the mission is really quite tightly focused on investigating the particular issue of whether or not, if an individual is persecuted within Pakistan, whether or not travelling to Rabwah would offer them protection from that persecution. Following contact from the Parliamentary Human Rights Group, the mission members came together, and the members were really selected because they have knowledge of the asylum system in the UK. And that's myself. I work as a researcher providing country information to support asylum cases and also to critique the asylum system itself. Michael Ellman, who is a solicitor with long-standing interest in human rights issues, and Francis Alwyn, who's a barrister who works in asylum cases. We formulated the mission with the express intention of contacting individuals in advance, we'd be able to answer the questions that we have, which are designed to really purely investigate the situation faced by Ahmadis within Rabwah itself. The interviewees were selected with the intention of maintaining a balanced report and an objective report. So whilst we interviewed the members of the Ahmadi community in Rabwah at some length, and they were able to give us the benefit of their personal experiences, we also sought the views of third parties such as the Pakistan Human Rights Commission and also Amnesty International Pakistan. We were also fortunate to gain access to a senior member of the government who was able to talk to us quite frankly on the issues facing religious minorities in Pakistan. But we also sought to speak to those groups who appear to be opposed to Ahmadis in Pakistan to also gain their perspective and to allow them to answer some of the challenges that have been put to them.
Well, I've been involved in asylum and immigration work now for about 10 years, actually practicing by actually sort of preparing and doing actual appeal work in the courts. I'm also a member of the Bar Human Rights Committee, and I received an email from them concerning the mission, and so I then contacted Lord Avery. We met and had a chat, and then it was decided that I would be part of the mission, and that's really how I got onto it. The mission itself was specifically looking at doing a report that could be used by the immigration courts in the UK, and to be used by practitioners to present in court as objective evidence as to the situation in Rabwah. The report will basically go to as many practitioners as possible, to solicitors and barristers. It will also go to the Home Office and to the Country and Information Office, which actually put out a report that the Home Office put in. So therefore, when it a case comes to court, the courts will then be in a position to actually use the report as objective background material, so that they can then look at the situation of an appellant who's made a claim as to whether or not there would be an internal flight alternative to Rabwah.
Can you tell us what happens to this report now that you've launched it and where it goes next?
Well, first of all, it goes to the practitioners and the immigration judges who deal with the asylum cases and who are frequently confronted with the Home Office claim that somebody who has been persecuted in Lahore or Faisalabad or wherever he came from may safely internally migrate to Rabwah. The purpose of this report was to look at the circumstances in which people are living in Rabwah and then to have that evidence available for the courts, which finally determine asylum applications, many of which turn on this internal flight issue. Well, I think personally that the situation in Rabwah is only part of a much bigger issue, and that we need to address the bigger issue as well, which is, of course, beyond the scope of the report. But, I mean, the reason why people are persecuted is because of the climate of opinion, the laws against the Ahmadis, particularly the blasphemy laws, from which they've suffered for many years, and the general atmosphere of discrimination and hatred, which is stirred up by a small minority of people. So, I mean, as we were saying during the discussion on this report, and there's a much wider question of how you can remove this climate of fear and hatred and ensure that the Ahmadis have the same equality of status as everybody else in Pakistan. I did go and see President Musharraf at the time when I was in Pakistan with Tony Coleman a few years ago, and we had what we thought was a very fruitful discussion with him over an hour and a half, and in the announcement that he then made about the first human rights program of his government, one of the ingredients was that people couldn't issue an FIR against not just an Ahmadi but any person without a senior officer of police approving it, because as you know many FIRs are launched for malicious or hostile reasons against Ahmadis, and that's an aspect of the law which we hoped he was going to correct. But then immediately there was a fuss by the mullahs and that proposal was withdrawn. So I think President Musharraf does face considerable difficulty with some of his own government indeed in trying to press for these kinds of reforms which are ultimately going to be necessary if the Ahmadis are going to enjoy religious freedom. I think we need a multinational approach. I was saying during the press conference, I think it isn't something that we can rely on anybody in the United Kingdom to do single-handed. In fact, maybe the United Kingdom is the wrong person to initiate it because of the history of relationships between our country and Pakistan. But I think the European Union should play a bigger role. I mean, one of the things we might easily do with this report is to go along and have a chat with the German ambassador, because the Germans at present occupy the presidency of the European Union. And so we would like to see some collective action by the European Union, and also, I think, by the new Human Rights Council, which has been established by the United Nations, and the instruments of the Human Rights Council, such as the Special Rapporteur on Religious Freedom.
I noticed some of the comments by the Human Rights Group of Pakistan were quite hard-hitting in showing the level of persecution. What did you think yourself?
Yes, I'm not surprised at all. I mean, we get a report each week which appalls me every time I receive it, because there are so many incidents throughout the country where persecution is taking place one way or the other. And unfortunately, the Ahmadis do not get protection from the authorities, which is very sad, because, as purely, as human beings, everyone, every citizen is entitled to proper protection by the law enforcement agencies, which doesn't seem to always happen.
One of the things this report doesn't do is derive a conclusion, and they've explained the reasons why that is there. What do you think needs to happen next with this report?
I was speaking to Lord Avery. We obviously won. This report will be widely distributed. Already we found that a lot of people who are here today have expressed interest in the report, and some of the agencies here have mentioned that they want to distribute this report to their subsidiary agencies in other parts of the world. So it will be widely distributed by the various agencies here. The press would obviously be interested, and hopefully through this report the whole case of the persecution will be highlighted. And hopefully, the pressure that it will bring will start bringing about change in Pakistan, because that's what we would really like.